Hello, everybody. I am Quan from Vietnam. So I come here to share my experience about applying open source software to build our mushroom farm, IoT mushroom farm. And this one is not for only mushroom farm because later on we expand it to other field as well, like in hydroponic farm and the bird house. So this is about me, so for you to know. So I come with first Asia for a long time, and I contribute to some open source software projects. And now I am working at Irrigation, a startup from Vietnam. So the guy before me, I think he already do very good in introduce how useful IoT farm can do, so I don't need to repeat again. So I will skip this part. Now, different from his setup, my system consists of the actuator, the sensor node, and the gateway. Here we don't use any cloud server because we build server ourselves. And not only it collect the environment condition, but we also use it to control the bump, the fan to moderate the condition in the farm. And the gateway is also play the role of a local server. Because we build our farm in a place with very poor internet connection. So we need the local server to control the farm automatically without the internet. So that if the internet go down, the system still can run. So this is the some image from what we built. We put some sensor next to the mushroom. And here are the humidifier. We use this to control the humidity in the farm, because the mushroom need a lot of humidity. And we also give it some light. So now here the software stuck. We build the software with Python and Django. And it's in the form of a web app, so that we can access it via browser in any devices, like in the PC or in mobile phone. And for the database, at first we use Postgres to store the sensor data, but later on we change to InfluxDB because the data is time series. Other data like farm, like user, we still use PostgreSQL. And this software running in a Linux computer, we need some software to integrate it to the operating system. Like for ARM Linux, we need the device G overlay, and to manage the services, we use systemd. And we separate, this is how the architecture of the software is. So we separate it to three modules. Module content view is for web UI and for displaying. The collector module to collect the data from the sensor. And the module control center is to control the actuator, like pump and fan. And we also need to periodically back up the database so that when something bad happens, we can recover the data. The database is uploaded to Yandex disk. We use Yandex disk because it is free. And to improve the speed of the software, we also need to review the Postgres index. This is the UI of our software, the control software. So this is in mobile view. This is the graph. This is already an old photo. Now we change the display a bit. Here is the UI for controlling. And here we set up for the system to run automatically. So when the temperature go high, it will based on this setup and control the fan to make the temperature go in the range we want. So here are four conditions that we control for the mushroom. And later on, when we expand to hydroponic and bird house, we add more conditions here. So this is how we access the system via internet, because we are not always in the farm. And as you know that our system run locally in the farm, so we need a way to access from internet. Our first method is to use VPN. So our software running here, and we are here in a different network. So we set up it with a public server to build a VPN network, this green line, so that our laptop and all the local server in our farm are in the same local network. This is the software that we try to build the VPN. So at first, we try Hamachi, but then we stop it because the Windows client is very unstable. One member of our team, he used Windows, so we also need to support Windows. And the second one that we try is SubEther VPN. And now we use the WireGuard, a very new VPN solution in Linux. And this is the second method that we do port forwarding on router. I think this method is very well known, so I don't need to go deeper. So this is the challenges we face when we build our system. So the first challenge is about the hardware. So the first challenge about the hardware, because we use a BeagleBone embedded computer. So here, do you know the Raspberry Pi? Yeah, and we use the BeagleBone instead of Raspberry Pi because of the internal memory. The BeagleBone doesn't use SD cards, so it's more stable when store the database. And so we connect directly the board with our devices, like the pump and the farm. So we have to solve the problem of hardware connection. So here we are GPIO. We connect to the GPIO port of the board, and Linux require root permission to control on that port. And our software need to run in normal user, so we have to do some check to able to control the GPIO port. Other issue is about the nature of multifunction of BeagleBone pin. So one pin can, this time it's be GPIO, or that time it can be BWM. And so we have to apply some specific solution about embedded computer to control this pin. And other issue is that the BeagleBone doesn't have RTC clock. So every time it's restarted, the time in the machine change and not correct. So we need internet. Sometimes we need the board to be connected with internet to update the time. There is also some problem with the software inside, like the DNS. So if the DNS not working, the time also wrong, and we have to fix the software also. About the database issue, at first we store the sensor data in normal schema of database. And because it produces a lot of data, like in every day it's write more than 80,000 records to the database. So time by time we found that our system run very slow on BeagleBone. And at first, we try to diagnose to see what is the wrong point in our database setup. And we found some SQL operation that's slow, and we apply some index to fix it. So but because the data is very big, so we don't index on the whole database, but we only index on recent record. And we need to regularly review the index so that it skip the old data and only build index for the most recent data. And after that, we change to another database solution. We apply InstructDB, and we move all the sensor data from PostgreSQL to InstructDB. InstructDB is more specific about time series database, so it provides some good feature to act on this kind of data. Like it has the feature to automatically summary our data. Like at first we collect data for every 10 seconds, but with this feature, we will downsampling our data to 10 minutes. When we try InfluxDB for a time, we compare with our solution with Postgres SQL, and we found that for the speed, it's the same as our solution of indexing, but the InfluxDB day by day it consumes a lot of RAM, and so now in our machine, the process, the InfluxDB process, it take it almost be the most heavy in the machine. And now we are thinking about try another solution. We recently found TimescaleDB, it's an extension on PostgreSQL, and it's a focus about time series database. But we haven't had a chance to try it because it doesn't support ARM now. Because our deployment to the customer, one, we have a system running on ARM, on BeagleBone, and other farm we deploy on mini PC. For mini PC, it's easy to set up TimescaleDB, but for ARM, for BeagleBone, there is still not the ARM build for TimescaleDB yet, so we haven't tried it. Okay, now my talk is finished now. Do you have any question?
Yeah. But regarding more on the hardware, so what kind of sensors did you use for your project?
There's an SIST for the temperature,
yeah.
And for the carbonic dioxide, we changed a lot. Now recently, we use the MZ. MMHZ 17. That one is for carbon dioxide. For the temperature, we still use SHT. Yeah. And for humidity, the SHT is measure both temperature and humidity. And for soil temperature, I forgot the name, but most of the sensors we buy from DF robot,
yeah.
Yeah, the distributor.